Chapter 13. We rested for a whole sun after the battle. We knew the soldiers could not follow until they got more mules. Lean Elk was less happy than the rest of the camp. He thought we should have taken the horses, too. He called me to his teepee. I combed my hair and braided it with strips of soft otter skin. I scrubbed my face with a wet cloth. I wiped the dirt off my elk-hide dress. Then I walked slowly across the camp, my skirt brushing the long grass. I was sure I was in trouble. For a long time, Lean Elk was silent. He looked at me with his burning eyes until I felt no bigger than a chipmunk. "I hear you played at Warrior last night," he said. He was not pleased. My words clattered like pebbles. I wanted to see the raid, I said.
"And your childish wish cost us a herd of horses," he said.
Anger chased away my fear. "I am not the one who fired the rifle," I said. "I went without a weapon. I am not a warrior, but I am not such a child as to warn the soldiers." Lean Elk tried to look stern, but the corners of his mouth would not stay still. He drew a hand across his lips to hide his smile.
"So you think you know more about war than our brave warriors?" he said.
"No," I said. "But I did not fight. I only watched."
"Next time, obey your father," he said. "Namipu women do not fight."
"The Bluecoats killed my mother. I would fight them if they came again," I said. "I would be as brave as the wife of Walitit. She fought beside her husband."
"She had battle thrust upon her," said Lean Elk. "You sought it out. You got in the way. Tuhoho sought nearly killed you." He was very angry. "Let us have no more of this playing at warrior. It does not become the future wife of a redcoat."
I did not know what to say. I had been in the way, and Tuhoho sought had nearly cut my throat. I nodded and spoke no more. We left the meadow the next morning in a steady rain. The trail grew steep. After two suns, we marched into the land of the spirit fountains, where a broad path ran along the riverbank. Elk and black-tailed deer grazed in the distance. It was still summer on the meadow, but leaves were turning scarlet in the high country. The streams ran from bank to bank with green water that would soon turn to ice. The rivers already were crusted with ice. Choke cherries that puckered the tongue rattled dry and bitter on their stems. Yet you could hold your breath, shut your eyes, make a face, and suck them down. This was a wondrous place. I had heard about its pools of churning mud and its fountains that sprayed into the heavens. Soon we came to a small fountain close to the trail, where water bubbled out and ran down to the rims. I stood beside the bubbling water and felt something move beneath my feet, cold, with the earth's deepest cold. It grew warm and spread out. It rose around my body with the warmth of human breath. There was a great rumbling, and from the center of the pool, white clouds of water spouted high above my head into a sky turned suddenly blue. We had stopped for food when there was a great commotion. The scouts came riding in, but they were not alone. White settlers rode with them. Two of the settlers were women. The one on a gray horse had seen as many snows as my mother. She had eyes the color of an early morning sky, a narrow nose, and a sharp chin. Her hair was the shade of dried grass, which she had twisted on top of her head. She was so strange-looking that I felt sorry for her. She wore many long skirts and sat with both legs on the same side of the horse. It seemed a foolish way to ride. The one on the spotted horse was younger, no older than I. She, too, sat sideways. Her eyes were green like spring grass. Her hair, the red gold of a setting sun, had come loose and hung around her shoulders. Her face was dirty. There were twigs and burrs in her hair and mud on her skirt. I guessed that she had tried to run away. The women seemed frightened, but they stared straight ahead and said nothing. Chief Joseph walked over and put his hand on the bridle of the gray horse.
"Do not be afraid," he said, using white words. "The soldiers killed many of our women and children at Big Hole, but we do not kill women.
The chiefs met in council and decided to let the settlers go, even the men. Lean Elk told them to get off their horses. When the settlers stood on the ground, a warrior led their fresh horses away. He brought back some of our worn-out ponies. With broken-down horses, it would take them several suns to get to the white soldiers. By then, we would be far across the mountains.
You are free to go, said Lean Elk. But do not spy on us.
The settlers left quickly. They were glad to get away. A moon showed in the east beyond the towering peaks of the Absaracus when we saw the settlers again. Fires burned around the edge of our camp. Swan Necklace and Ferocious Bear rode between the fires, pushing one white man and the two women before them. My father strode over and began to talk with the warriors. His voice rose in anger. Swan Necklace and Ferocious Bear turned their horses away, and my father brought the settlers to our fire. The settlers had broken their word. Once they were out of sight, the men slid to the ground and came back along the river, spying on our camp. Our scouts found them skulking in the brush along the river. There was a fight, and three of the men ran away. Our scouts captured the woman with yellow hair, her young sister, and her brother. But two of the men were shot. That made my father angry because the settlers had given us their guns. He shook his head.
Swan Necklace has become as foolish as Waliditz, he said. He will make trouble for us, killing unarmed men.
I motioned to the settlers to sit down. Yellow Hair and Dirty Face were the first white women I had seen so close. I stared at them. They were not pretty, but they did not look evil. The white man smiled at me. I said to myself that he was a wicked man and would kill me if he could. I looked away and did not smile. While I prepared our evening meal, Bending Willow began to cry. I did not leave the fire, but her cries stopped. I heard soft murmurs and turned to see Yellow Hair rocking the cradle board. Soon Bending Willow was fast asleep. The settlers ate baked camas roots and antelope I cooked on sticks. They did not complain. After our meal, the white man said some words in our tongue to Chief Joseph, but my father would not answer. He stared into the glowing coals. His heart was troubled. I knew he was worried about what to do with our prisoners. After our meal, I sat beside the young green-eyed prisoner. She shrank back against the buffalo robe held up by stakes that protected us from the cold. I smiled, and touching my chest said, "Sound of running feet." Then I waited. She did not say her name, so I touched her cheek and pointed to her chest. "Dirty Face," I said. She looked wildly from side to side. It was no use. She did not understand. That night, the settlers slept in front of the fire next to our shelter. I gave them buffalo robes against the cold. Dirty Face pulled her robe around her and began to cry. Yellow Hair spoke softly to her. She put her arm about the girl's shoulders and comforted her, as a mother would comfort a hurt child. It puzzled me to see that white women acted no different from women of the Namipu.